Good afternoon and welcome to all students for refresher course 2021. Now I will discuss the topic obstetric emergencies. What is an emergency? Emergency is an acute serious event, often dangerous in nature, can have catastrophic consequences and which require immediate attention in order to save life. And it is a difficult situation to handle. These obstetric emergencies are high risk for children, and we have to consider two lives. How will we react to this obstetric emergency? We have to recognize the acute problem and call for help, take the multidisciplinary team approach, and we have to know the key algorithm and drill. And always remember that mothers come first. What are the causes? The antepartum causes are the hemorrhage, emergency cesarean section, category 1, preeclampsia, eclampsia, or HELLP syndrome, uterine inversion or rupture, uterine trauma. In the postpartum causes, the postpartum hemorrhage and postpartum eclampsia. Other causes as amniotic fluid embolus, pulmonary embolus, DIC, anaphylaxis, cardiac arrest. Obstetric hemorrhage is the one of the leading cause related to maternal death worldwide. In India, the incidence of maternal mortality due to hemorrhage is 35 to 56%. 2 of the 55% deliveries, they are complicated by the postpartum hemorrhage. This massive uncontrolled hemorrhage, which happens in the last trimester of the pregnancy, is because of the increased cardiac output. There is increase in the cardiac output up to 30 to 50% above the pre-labor value at 32 weeks. And it increases further to 50 to 80% at second and third stage of labor, as which lead to the rapid inflow of blood to the uterus in the late pregnancy. This may be concealed or you will get the late sign of hypovolemia. How will you assess the blood loss? Usually up to 20 to 30% of the blood loss, you will get only the tachypnea and tachycardia and narrow pulse pressure. When the loss is more than 30%, you will get the hypotension along with tachycardia and tachypnea. When loss is more than 40%, you will get the patient in shock, BP may be not recordable, alternate consciousness may be altered, or anuria. Why this happens? When there is a decrease in the blood pressure and the cardiac output, there is a simultaneously increase in the systemic vascular resistance. This is the compensatory mechanism of the body and which increases and reach to the plateau level at 40% of the blood loss. The type of the this hemorrhage may be antepartum or postpartum. Incidence and causes, the late pregnancy in the placenta previa, abruption and DIC. The postpartum, as I told you, the uterine atony and the surgical trauma. What is placenta previa? When the placenta implant in advance of the fetal presenting part, the incidence is 1 in 200 pregnancies. This may be total placenta previa, partial placenta previa, or marginal placenta previa. Especially the total placenta previa, when the placenta covers the entire os, it is a dangerous situation. Placenta previa may be associated with the placenta accreta, increta, or percreta. Accreta, when the placenta is adherent to the myometrium without invasion through the uterine muscle. And when it invaded to the myometria is increta, and when it invade to the uterine serosa and other pelvic structure, it is a placenta percreta. Double setup examination of the placenta for this usually done as an emergency procedure. And this is done in the OT, all the preparation for the cesarean section to be done, and the monitor to be attached to know the vital parameter of the patient, and the two large bore IV cannulae to be put for the management of hemorrhage, administration of anti-aspiration prophylaxis to be done, and all aseptic precaution to be taken before starting the examination, and arrange the PRBC in advance before doing the procedure. What will be the technique of choice? It depends upon the indication, urgency, and degree of hypovolemia. There is a high risk of intraoperative blood loss. Suppose the patient developed the atonia during cesarean section, and the patient is under neuraxial block, then we should have to convert into the GA for the better oxygenation, ventilation, and better control of the hemodynamics. And suppose there is required the hysterectomy, we can better manage under general anesthesia. So how will you manage? How will you proceed? We have to always evaluate the extent of blood loss and all the problem concerned to the obstetric this hemorrhage. We have to resuscitate and prepare for the operative delivery. Especially the airway assessment is very important thing because of the physiological changes of the pregnancy, and we have to prepare for the difficult intubation and know the extent of the blood loss and intravascular volume to be known, so we can do the aggressive fluid replacement. And along with this, we have to provide the oxygen to the mother and maintain the left uterine displacement to prevent the aorto cable compression. Along with this, we have to put the two large bore IV cannula, as I told you, arrange the blood and coagulation status to be checked, and also prepare for the invasive monitoring and blood to be sent for the investigation, especially the CBC, prothrombin vein time, partial thromboplastin time, and platelet count, and fibrinogen level to be known, and D-dimer to be done. Bedside coagulation testing as thromboelastography and thromboelastometry is the time-sensitive testing, and this tell about the real clotting status of the patient. Volume replacement, especially the immediate aggressive volume replacement to be done with the help of crystalloid. When the blood is available, we have to give the blood to the patient. If it is found, then when the loss is fluid is replaced more than 80% to manage this blood loss, then chances of DIC is there, and we have to arrange the platelet and FFP and cryoprecipitate to correct the other abnormalities related to coagulation. Regarding the regional anesthesia, so the regional anesthesia only be done when the patient is hemodynamically stable and she has no history of recent bleeding, and for the elective cesarean delivery. Otherwise, in a bleeding parturient and patient having history of bleeding, it will be a good big question for the anesthesiologist. So never take under regional anesthesia to the bleeding parturient. Regarding the general anesthesia, rapid sequence induction to be done, and propofol should not be used in the hypovolemic patient. Ketamine in the dose of 0.5 to 1 milligram is a good choice, or we can give the etomidate in the dose of 0.3 milligram per kg. It is the best induction agent for the bleeding patient. Suppose if patient is in severe shock and unconscious, we can do the intubation as a crash intubation with the help of only muscle relaxant. Centiacrita, it required the close coordination among the anesthesiologist, optician, and the interventional radiologist, along with the blood blind personnel. So we have to discuss the problem and manage according to the plan. Sometimes they have these patients, they have to headed toward the cesarean hysterectomy, which is the traditional expectation. So we have to mentally prepare for this and manage accordingly. If patient bleed too much during intraoperative period, there is a massive transfusion protocol for this, where the blood bank has to release 6 units of O negative PRBC and 4 units of ABFFP, and within this this releasing the 6 and 4 unit of FFP, here the blood bank has to release the another 10 units of ERBC, 10 unit of FFP, and 10 unit of platelet, and 10 units of cryoprecipitate. If required, they have to provide the factor 7 also, if it is requested. What is the role of autologous cell salvage? This is not done in obstetric cases because there is a risk of amniotic fluid embolism and maternal alloimmunization. Damage control resuscitation is used in the obstetric patient also to decrease the use of crystalloid and colloid, and where the transfusion of ERBC, FFP, and platelet done in the ratio of 1:1:1 to avoid the development of dilutional coagulopathy. Cryoprecipitate and the antipremolytics, especially they are administered when there is a high ratio of FFP, PRBC is given. The cryoprecipitate is given in the dose of 3 mg per kg to raise the fibrinogen level of 1 gram per liter. Postpartum hemorrhage is also a leading cause of the maternal death. In developing countries, the incidence is 1 in 1,000 delivery. These postpartum hemorrhage may be primary or secondary. Primary usually during the first 24 hour, while the second is 24 hours to 6 weeks postpartum. There is regarding the etiology, there is a 4 T's of primary PPH. Tone is the important factor for the development of PPH in 90% of the cases. Other important cause is the retained product of conception, placenta previa or abrasion. There may be trauma to genital tract or uterine rupture. Thrombin, especially the coagulopathy or thrombotic dilutional coagulopathy, is the other cause. How will you manage the uterine atony? The uterotonics are the important, you have to know about this. Start along with this blood transfusion and everything. You have to give the oxytocin in the dose of 10 to 20 sometime, because if you give in the rapid infusion of oxytocin may lead to the hypotension, and it may be problematic in cases when the patient already having a hypotension because of the hemorrhage. Methyl ergometrine or methergine in the dose of 0.2 milligram IM or intramyometrically can be given. It may lead to the hypertension, dysarrhythmias, or coronary bypass. Prostaglandin E1 analog, misoprostol, it can be given orally or sublingually in the dose of 800 microgram. It causes the bronchoconstriction. Prostaglandin F2 alpha in the dose of 1000 microgram, it can be given rectally or sublingually. It increases the pulmonary artery pressure and leading to the bronchospasm. Carboplast is especially preferred in cases of the patient having refractory uterine atony in the dose of 250 microgram. It also leads to the bronchospasm. Regarding the hemostatic drug, nexamic acid, it is given 1 gram IV stat and second dose after 30 minutes. Then infusion is given 1 gram per hour over 6 hours. Regarding the recombinant factor 7 or novocymin, it is used as a rescue therapy in unresponsive massive hemorrhage and given in the dose of 90 microgram per kg stat, then followed by 120 microgram if bleeding persists. But before administration, we have to assure that the platelet should be more than 50,000, fibrinogen level should be more than 0.5 gram per liter, and patient should not be in metabolic acidosis. Buckley balloon is also very much used by the obstetrician for the control of hemorrhage, where they have to put the balloon and inflate with 300 to 500 ml of saline and put in the uterine cavity. The surgical techniques used for this are the uterine compression sutures, as V-Lin suture. This is also very much term used by the obstetrician. Devascularization procedure as bilateral uterine artery ligation or bilateral internal iliac artery ligation is also done to control the hemorrhage. Sometimes hysterectomy has to perform, especially in case of the uterine atony or placenta accreta. Radiological management, as I told you, embolization usually done by the radiologist. They identify the bleeding vessel and embolize the artery under the local anesthesia. Angiographic occlusion of the balloon catheter. Balloon is placed in the hypogastric or common iliac arteries and as a temporizing agent. So how will you approach? Call for help, assess the airway, breathing and circulation, provide the supplementary oxygen, and left uterine displacement, obtain the wide bore intravenous line, start the IV replacement with the IV fluid crystalloid, and monitor the vital sign. Size the bladder, and so you can able to know the urine output, need for the blood transfusion, arrange the blood and blood product, and send the blood for the CBC, coagulation, and blood group. Management of uterine rupture. It is also a dire emergency where urgent laparotomy is performed for the delivery of the baby. And management of hemorrhage, because patient usually very rapidly decompensate, and invasive monitoring is required. Inversion or management of uterine inversion. This immediate diagnosis has to be made, and uterus has to be inverted immediately. And rapid uterine relaxation is required. Usually it is done with the help of nitroglycerin intravenously, 50 to 200 microgram, depending upon the muscle uterine relaxation. And in the you have also support the circulation with the fluid and use of vasopressors. So the GA with the inhalational agent, especially the most preferred technique, and any halogenated anesthetic can be used for this purpose. An important cause of this obstetric emergency is the category 1 cesarean section, and most of the anesthesiologists, they are getting the call for the emergency cesarean section where there is an immediate threat to life of mother and fetus. And various neuroaxial technique used for these are the spinal, epidural, or CSC, or continuous spinal, depending upon the stage of labor and delivery, or we can give general anesthesia. Usually GA versus GA is only kept for when we are not having an indication for the regional anesthesia, or we have contraindication for regional anesthesia. Why? Because the general anesthesia is associated with the higher morbidity and mortality because of the problem of intubation and aspiration pneumonia. But especially in cases of the fetal distress or where the emergency cesarean, urgent or emergent cesarean section has to be performed, this GA can be given very quickly, and blood pressure is more easily controlled with the GA. And in the bleeding patient or patient having a clotting abnormalities, GA is the choice. In the neurological problem patient also, we can do them. But it requires the more expertise as compared to regional anesthesia. Suppose the patient on the anticoagulant and the antiplatelet drug, what will be the regime for the neuraxial block? This unfractionated heparin, if patient on this unfractionated heparin, the removal of epidural catheter should occur 1 hour prior or 4 hours following the subsequent heparin doses. Patient on the low molecular weight heparin, like enoxaparin, the epidural catheter should be removed 4 hours prior to first dose of low molecular weight. Neuraxial anesthesia should not be performed if the patient has received the antifibrinolytic or thrombolytic therapy. For the general anesthesia, we have to take all the precaution against the aspiration, anti-aspiration prophylaxis to be given. either ranitidine or maxiron 10 milligram intravenously. We have to apply the monitor, put the patient in the left uterine displacement, and provide the optimal airway position. Arrange the all the equipment for the failed intubation, difficult airway cart to be ready with the supraglottic devices. We have to pre-oxygenate the patient for the 100% oxygen for at least 3 to 5 minutes. Because these patients having a low FRC and more chances of desaturation at the time of induction intubation. After they drape the patient and the surgeon are ready, then we start with the RSI with induction agent or like propofol, ketamine, depending upon the hemodynamic, and relax with the succinylcholine in the dose of 1 to 1.5 milligram per kg and apply the required pressure and verify the endotracheal tube position and cuff inflated. After assuring the proper placement of endotracheal tube, we can ventilate with 50% oxygen and 50% nitrox oxide with volatile anesthetic as necessary. And after delivery of baby, we can increase the nitrous up to 66%. And we can also administer the OPR. And after delivery, we can give the oxytocin 5 units slow IV and 20 to 40 unit per 100 ml in normal saline at the rate of 125 ml per hour. And reverse the block and at the end of the surgery, and patient should be awake and responding to the verbal command. The preeclampsia and eclampsia, which is also a life-threatening complication and posted for the emergency cesarean section. And it is third leading cause of pregnancy-related death after the hemorrhage and embolism. So prognosis is always poor, and they are associated with the complication, and there are the concern regarding the multi-system failure, as there is a high risk of maternal mortality, 1 in 50 women. 23% of these may require the ventilation and management in ICU. 35% may be associated with the risk of pulmonary edema, hepatorenal failure, or renal failure, or DIC, or HELLP syndrome, or even acute respiratory distress syndrome. There may be chances of intracranial hemorrhage or cardiac arrest or stillbirth or neonatal death. There is some sign, especially in the severe preeclampsia or eclampsia. These are known as the danger sign. When the BP is very high, more than 180 or 200, and diastolic is also more than 120, the patient may develop the encephalopathy, or there may be intracranial bleed. If in the eye, you will get the exudate or papilledema or hemorrhages. On investigation, you will find the proteinuria more than 2+ or 3+, and urine protein creatinine ratio of more than 30. And there is also one another criteria for judging the severity of eclampsia, which is known as the Eden criteria. And when the coma of 6 or more hours is present, or the patient having a temperature of 39 degree or more, pulse is over 120 per minute, or blood pressure is over 200 millimeter of mercury, or respiratory rate is more than 40 per minute, or patient might be having a more than 10 convulsions, these are considered as a severe eclampsia or verge on the complication. So what will be the management? Aim for the management, we always ensure the maternal and fetal well-being and maintain the patent airway for proper oxygenation and ventilation, and prevent and control the fits. We have to control the blood pressure, ascertain the fluid balance, deliver the fetus, and effective postpartum care has to be given for proper outcome, and manage the complication if the patient has developed the complication. So how will you approach this patient, we immediately call for help. As I told you, it is a multidisciplinary team approach. Secure the airway, place the plate, assess the guard the IV line and control the convulsion and control the hypertension. Usually because being an emergency, dire emergency, so you have to give the IV hydralazine or lobetalol, or even thus you can give the infusion of sodium nitroprusside to control the blood pressure. Anticonvulsant is the magnesium sulfate, is the drug of choice. And fluid should be given very guarded in the dose of 1 to 2 ml per kg per hour with urine output monitoring. Regarding the proper control of BP and control of convulsion, discussed by the previous speaker, Madam Shukla. Regarding the seizure control, usually the magnesium sulfate is the drug of choice for this, but it should be monitored by the loss of patellar reflex, respiratory depression, and urine output. Another regime, one method is you have to give the 4 to 6 grams low IV bolus over 5 to 10 minutes, then 1 to 2 grams per hour IV infusion. Another method is that you can give the 5 grams in each buttock, total of 10 grams intramuscularly. Other drugs used for the seizure control are the phenytoin, sodium thiopentone, midazolam, and sometimes patient need the muscle relaxation. MAGPIE trial also shows the efficacy of magnesium sulfate, and it is found that there is a reduction in the incidence of eclampsia up to 59% with the use of magnesium sulfate. There is a reduction in the abruption and 46% reduction in the maternal death. And if patient having a ECG changes or loss of deep tendon reflex or respiratory depression, then you have to give the 10% calcium gluconate 10 ml to manage the toxicity of magnesium sulfate by slow IV injection to counteract the effect of magnesium sulfate. Another thing you have to keep in mind that magnesium sulfate crosses the placenta and can lead to the fetal hypotonia and the respiratory depression. So the neonatologist or pediatrician should be present at the time of delivery. So in nutshell, the anesthetic consideration, the patient having severe eclampsia or preeclampsia, you should always assess for the fluid balance. And this patient might have the risk of developing pulmonary edema because of the leaky capillaries. And you have to always assess them. There may be chances of the nephropathy or neuropathy. So you have to assess the renal, hepatic, and CNS function, assess the airway, coagulation status, and elevated liver enzymes, and give the patient about the seizure prophylaxis, magnesium sulfate, and check for the fetal well-being. Final anesthesia and severe eclampsia, this according to the Nelson and Angelo, an aggressive approach to provide regional anesthesia in patient with the severe eclampsia should have to always be considered in an attempt to reduce the overall risk. So can spinal anesthesia be considered? Then question arises. If the patient, if you have to check the clotting screen, if the patient having no coagulopathy, it is a choice. You can give, you provide the very smooth control of BP and maintain the uteroplacental perfusion also. And it also avoid this hemodynamic problem associated with the GA. CSC is the current technique of choice in severe preeclampsia for the cesarean section, because also can give the pain control after the delivery. GA, for the GA, as I told you, you have to take the anti-aspiration prophylaxis, pre-oxygenation at least for 3 to 5 minutes and rapid control of it. But the important thing you have to keep in mind, you have to attenuate the pressure response to laryngoscopy with the help of hydralazine or lobetalol or esmolol, especially the esmolol in the dose of 1 to 2 milligram per kg immediately prior to induction is very helpful, or even the nitroglycerin. Always give the lidocaine in the dose of 1 mg/kg during induction to block the pacer response. Always anticipate difficult airway, so you have to arrange the difficult airway cart and a small size endotracheal. Always ensure the proper depth of anesthesia, and so use the 2/3 MAC of inhalational agent. Monitor the magnesium sulfate during maintenance of anesthesia, as it potentiate the depolarizing and non-depolarizing nerve cell relaxant. So a peripheral neuromuscular monitor to be used for management of the muscle relaxation and repeat dose of muscle relaxant. And with magnesium sulfate, there is a risk of uterine atony also. So you have to give the oxytocin and the carboplast during the management of PPS patient. Magnesium sulfate usually contraindicated in myasthenia gravis and due to muscle weakness, and especially used cautiously in cases of the calcium channel blocker, which also can lead to hypotension. So regarding the guideline for the eclampsia patient, if the patient having normal ICP, no clinical evidence of bleeding, and maintain platelet count is more than 80,000, you can consider the regional anesthesia. And the patient having a raised ICP and bleeding and platelet count is low, you have to avoid the neuraxial technique. There is also ABC approach, where we have to take care of airway breathing and circulation and take the help of magnesium sulfate antihypertensive. Important cause is the amniotic fluid embolism, which is the fifth most common cause of the maternal mortality, and it known as the NF blood diet syndrome of the pregnancy. And three major manifestations which lead to the morbidity and mortality is the acute pulmonary embolism, DIC, and uterine atony. And because of this activation of inflammatory cascade, they lead to the DIC, and the patient develop the ARDS, and all these hypovolemia and hypoxemia lead to the neurological insult. So anesthesiologists have to take care of all these problems. For the patient develop the sudden maternal collapse, you have to stabilize the cardiovascular and the respiratory system, take care of the coagulation status, correct the coagulopathy, and immediate cesarean section is required, where you have to optimize the fluid balance, and if required, vasopressor support to be given to the patient. There is the algorithm. You have to call for help, give high flow of oxygen the patient with the amniotic fluid embolism, fetal monitoring to be done, and optimize the preload with the fluid and the vasopressor, and consider the invasive hemodynamic monitoring and coagulopathy to be corrected with the blood and blood product. And there is a role of hydrocortisone also. In sepsis, there is in first hour of the sepsis, there is a sepsis 6 protocol for the severe sepsis, where the patient to be transferred in the ICU and give the high flow of oxygen to achieve the SpO2 of more than 94%. And blood should be sent for the blood culture, and antibiotic to be administered, and fluid given in the dose of 20 ml/kg if the patient having a lactate of more than 4 mmol/L. Within 6 hours of the sepsis, you have to start the vasopressor to maintain the hemodynamic, and especially the mean RT pressure should be more than 65 mmHg. And serial measurement of lactate has to be done. Obstetric trauma, suppose the patient developed the trauma during the pregnancy, then the patient should be managed as a urgent, and within the 10 minutes, which is known as the platinum time, a patient should be stabilized, resuscitated and stabilized, and transferred to the OT for the further management. And there is a summary for the trauma recommendation regarding this. Suppose you achieve the patient, as anesthesiologist, you receive the call, distress call of the pregnant, bleeding pregnant patient in the ED. So you have to follow the ATLS guideline for this, and maintain the airway patency ventilation and the cardiovascular stability, ensure left lateral tilt up to 15 to 30 degree, anticipate and suspect hypovolemia, so aggressive resuscitation, always resuscitate the true life, keeping in mind and maintain the ICP, avoid the hypoxemia and hypovolemia, and resuscitate, suppose if the you are not able to resuscitate and patient develop the cardiac arrest in the meantime, then the perimortem cesarean section to be done within 4 minutes. If suppose the patient develops cardiac arrest in the pregnancy, this is also an emergency, and anesthesiologist have to manage this cardiac arrest of obstetric parturient. So there are obstetric causes, as I told you, the hemorrhage, preeclampsia, not include the non-obstetric causes. Now we are also getting the peripartum cardiomyopathy also. So you have to keep in mind, you have to take care of this cardiac arrest as a team, and every member of the team has to assign the work, like a co-team leader should be there, airway person who has to manage the airway, chest compression person, vascular assist person, drug administration person, and one person for the recording, and obstetrician have to perform the cesarean delivery, and pediatrician have to manage the. There is a technique to displace the uterus. This may be done by the two hand method as shown, and one hand you replace the displace the uterus to the opposite side, left side, and do the compression above the nipple in cases of the pregnant patient more than 24 week gestation or full term pregnant patient who develop the cardiac arrest. So how will you proceed? Check responsiveness, activate emergency response system, and ask for the AED. And in the meantime, you have to provide the chest compression, manage the airway and breathing. And if get the defibrillator, then you have to check whether it is a shockable rhythm or non-shockable rhythm. If it is a VFVT, then give shock. So for the perimortem cesarean section, if it is less than 24 weeks, continue CPR. Fetal considerations are secondary. If it is more than 24 weeks, then evacuate the uterus by 5 minutes and do the CPR. If it is unsuccessful, always consider the direct cardiac massage or bypass after 15 minutes. There is a new guideline in the 2020 regarding the resuscitation of the pregnant patient. So they have given the high priority to the high quality CPR, push hard, push fast, you already know. And you have to give the high flow of oxygen to this patient and defibrillate, then get the defibrillator. And important thing is that you have to consider the etiology. For this, they have given a mnemonic of ABCD, EFGH. Means A for anesthetic complication, always keep in mind, which may lead to the cardiac arrest, as very high spinal or drug toxicity may lead to the arrest. And so you can manage accordingly if you know the cause. If there is a cause of bleeding, then manage the bleeding. Cardiovascular means associated cardiovascular problem. If drug may lead to the this, you have. If you are suspecting the embolic phenomenon, you have to manage. And similarly, if the patient, especially for the other causes, that is the 5H and 5T. You know this hypoxia, hypercarbia, hypotension, so this hypovolemia, so you have to take care of it accordingly. And now this is the nutshell. Thank you very much and good luck for coming examination. Thank you once again. These are the references. Thank you.